This is Ham Radio Now, the most important amateur radio program on the internet. And this is episode 334, the 2017 Field Day Tour. Finally. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ. Are you done with Field Day yet? I hope not. I hope you've got a little more interest for this show. I'm sorry it took so long to edit. There's a lot here. More on that in a minute. But first, Ham Radio Now is a proud member of the Begging for Funding Foundation. It was established by our CEO, back there, Arvin, based on this brilliant idea by Bob Heil, K9EID from Ham Nation.
Now, we can do like others and beg for it. I absolutely detest that. We cannot beg in ham radio.
So, credit where credit is due. You can join the foundation, show your support for the show, stop by hamradionow.tv, and click the pig. All right, on with the tour. Oh, no, wait. First, I want to stop at Jason's tour for Ham Radio 2.0. Jason, KC5HWB. Jason got his tour out first. So, you know, fair is fair. And this is a little bit from his tour. And I have drone envy. Really do. He's got a lot of drone shots in his tour. So it's cool. But Jason, you know, just a word of caution, don't overdo it. It's pretty cool. Yeah, I think that's just more drone envy. But it is really easy to overdo drone shots. Okay, so now my tour. This is one of those plans that actually worked. Surprised almost. My friend Karl Bowman, W5. I'm stuck with Jason. My friend Karl Bowman, W4CHX, is the North Carolina section manager. Karl lives not too far away here in Raleigh. We've both been involved in the Raleigh Amateur Radio Society. We're both past presidents of that club. I went on to do this TV show, this little rinky-dink begging for dollars wannabe TV show. And Karl has gone on to start becoming a big wheel in the ARRL. And now, North Carolina is a big state. Well, it's a wide state. Not all that tall, but it's really wide, like 500 miles wide. It's all one ARRL section. So it's a lot of territory for a section manager to cover. And that means that hams in some parts of the section don't see their section manager all that often. Field Day is a good opportunity for the section manager to visit hams who are all out doing the same thing on the same weekend. So Karl and a lot of other section and division level ARRL officials all over the country like to tour as much of their territory as they can on Field Day. And the hams out there really love showing off their Field Day operations, so they like to get those visits. Last year, Karl visited the eastern half of the state. And this year, he planned to head west. And I suggested that we go together. Could be fun. He thought it was a great idea. The surprising thing is it actually happened. And there's no reason why it shouldn't. It's just that I plan a lot of things. And only a few of them actually happen. Well, I'm glad this one did. We had a great time. Karl laid out a list of clubs that he wanted to visit. And I used the ARRL Field Day Locator and Google Maps, where'd the Google Maps go? Oh, there we go. To lay out a route. And so we started over here, Carl's house. That's Cindy. We're using that share location thing, so I know where she is at all times. And we followed this route throughout the entire Field Day. Google Maps only lets you put 10 spots in for planning a route. So one more stop after that, we stopped there in Statesville, and then we went home. So this 498 miles in 9 hours, 58 minutes, you add another couple hours to get home from that. And the Field Day Locator was really handy. It showed all the station locations, so I was able to plot them on the map. We didn't visit every one of these, but we visited a lot of those in this territory. We took the Q-mobile because, well, Karl doesn't really do mobile, doesn't have a mobile installation. And because one of the things that you learn about when you visit a bunch of field day sites in one weekend, and I've done this before back when I was editing that Sarah repeater journal and did that for a couple of years. One of the things you learn when you're visiting a bunch of sites in one weekend is you spend a lot of time driving between those sites. It's often an hour or more of driving, and then you stick at a site for about a half hour or so. So if you've got a good HF mobile, that means you get to operate field day as a one Charlie mobile station. And we did. And you'll see some of that during the show. Karl did the operating and the driving, and I did the logging and the tuning. And we made a total of, I think, about 62 contacts. So we didn't burn it up. Karl was impressed how well we did breaking into pileups and stuff from a mobile station. And by the way, I've always called my car the Q-mobile because of, well, KN4AQ. But Karl assumed that I called it that because of how easy it was to make Qs, QSOs, the QSO mobile. Okay, so now I think that too. And because of KN4AQ. And by the way, if you want to get a good look at the Q-mobile, go back to Ham Radio Now episode number 300 and I show that off. And then I get on the road down to Orlando last year. Let's see. Okay, so I picked up Karl bright and early on Saturday morning, and we headed out to our first stop, the Forsyth Amateur Radio Club, W4NC, just outside of Winston-Salem. Everything is in North Carolina. I'm going to stop saying North Carolina. I think I'm going to say that a lot on the video, though. W4NC, the Forsyth Club, is one of the bigger clubs in North Carolina, and we got there well before the 2 o'clock start time. So you'll see them in the early stages of setting up. And now I think I can just go to the videotape.
Hey, you guys, Ham Radio Now is on the road. It is field day, and I am here with the North Carolina section manager, Karl Bowman, W4CHX. You're a, get that microphone up by your face. I'm picked up by this one here.
Good morning, everyone. We're in Winston-Salem at Hobby
Lost
Park.
Lost control of the show already.
We're in Winston-Salem at Hobby Park at the field day site for the Forsyth Amateur Radio Club. Gary and I are putting up with each other during the next couple of days, traveling from site to site. We wanted to visit this one first off. It's about 9:30 a.m. on Saturday, and clearly the club is getting together and setting up the radios under the shelter. They've done antenna setup yesterday. We've got several club members that are going to join us and give an explanation. So, Gary, back to you.
Yeah, what do you guys got?
My name is Jim Register. I KV4SJ. Got my license 2013. We are 9A.
9A?
9A.
So okay, so that's like huge.
Well, yes. And it's a pretty big setup. We kind of cook along for a while to get this going. We've got a number of antennas to pull up yet. We've got the double H beams over there to your left on the table. We've got a couple out there. We've got some receive antennas about 1,000 feet away, down behind the tarps. We got a 2-meter beam at the other end. We've got a 6-meter beam on a mast, and we're going to be putting a 10-meter beam up there as well.
How many people will be here?
We're planning for 60 to 80.
Through
you know, last year I think we had 80 people.
Here's a good way to figure it out. How many people are going to be here for dinner?
Catering for 60. Some of us are going to have to go away. We got a lot of us that have conflicts, you know, unfortunately. People got weddings. People had the nerve to plan weddings on field day.
That makes no sense. Because now, for the rest of their life.
Right.
They're it's...
It's
anniversary or field day.
Yeah,
get their spouse licensed.
Yep.
Doc Holliday.
That's right.
Weren't you at the OK Corral?
Yeah, we're here fresh from the OK Corral. And Jesse James said to tell you hello. But I'm not packing a gun today. I'm packing a lot of other things. I've been chairman
Give your call sign to the audio
WB4QYZ.
Audience.
WB4QYZ.
Okay, what's your job here?
I am publicity chairman. And I've worked hard to get a lot of people here today, so I hope we're going to have about 100 here today.
How do you do that? What do you do?
Newspapers, radio, television, especially the weather report people. We go speak at places like Salvation Army where they have youth groups, and you get to speak to them. We've had Boy Scout groups here, which is excellent. But the newspaper people give us, we got a lady coming out in the morning at 10 o'clock with a photographer. She's going to be doing this event.
So some of the press has given you commitments that they'd be here already.
Oh, yes,
because I've done this a lot, and no one ever says, yeah, I'm going to come.
Oh, yeah.
They just kind of show up maybe.
She called me yesterday. I'll be there at 10 a.m.
Excellent.
Ready to take pictures and write up the event. So we're, in fact,
How do you contact them? Do you send out faxes?
Well, we have a lady who works at the newspaper that's a ham operator.
Oh,
so we got
built
an inside job.
When you're doing the publicity, you mentioned the dinosaurs, the TV stations, the newspapers, the radio stations.
Right.
What about new media? What about the new stuff?
We do Facebook, Instagram. We use our own website to get the news out. Yes.
But that way people have to come to you. Is there any way to reach out to the new media community and find those folks, find the general public? Can that be done? I don't know how.
Yes, it can. One of the best ways is at HamFest that we have. You know, we've just had a HamFest, our group here, and we told them about it there.
More and more people are pouring in here.
Yeah,
we've got busy.
We'll have a lot of folks. Let's see, there's Jason. Hey, Jason, come over here and say hello to the group. And he's one of our...
Yeah, there's somebody who's not 70 years old.
Right.
Yes. He only needs one mic.
I'm 80 years old.
Who are you?
My name is... All right, yeah. Yeah, my name is Mason, KM4SII.
How old are you?
14.
How long you been a ham?
A little bit more than a year. I got licensed last March.
Okay, so you were at Field Day last year.
Yeah, I was.
Okay.
I upgraded my general just a week or two before Field Day, so I was here.
All right, and you came back.
Yep.
So you must be enjoying this thing.
Oh yeah, definitely.
Are there any other people your age in this group?
In this group, yeah, we have a couple, and we have a youth group that I'm a member of that's got a bunch of members all over the U.S. too. So.
I've never been on a de-expedition, but he has.
Which one did you
Iceland.
Go on? Hold that mic up close.
Yeah, I did a little single operator expedition to Iceland in March.
To Iceland?
Yes, it was a little bit cold, but a lot of fun.
In March, yeah, it's still winter there.
Oh, yeah. It was about freezing the whole time we were there.
Was that your whole purpose for going, or was it a family trip?
Yeah, it was a family vacation. It was a tour group, so I just had a little bit of spare time, but I got on 40 meters and worked some Europeans and Asians. It's pretty nice.
Pile-ups?
The noise was really bad, so I couldn't hear a lot of people calling, but did have a lot of people calling.
I think I read about that. Where were you written up?
Number of places. I was on DX News, on the ARRL's page, a couple other things like that.
Okay, yeah, that sounds really familiar. All right, so you guys have a great field day. We're going to hit the road again, aren't we, Karl?
Yes, we'll be on the road again.
Hey, Kilo November 4, Alpha Quebec, Mobile in North Carolina near Winston-Salem. My name is Gary, Golf Alpha Romeo Yankee on Highway 421. And I'm riding a shotgun along with Karl, Whiskey 4 Charlie Hotel X-Ray. Karl is the section manager for North Carolina, and we are on a field day tour, looking at field day stations all over the western part of North Carolina. It is 81 degrees and mostly sunny, and my South Car's number is 1872.
1872
K4AQ Mobile. Here, you're signal there from your mobile station there, K4AQ Mobile.
Okay, there was another mobile station.
All of a sudden, there's people. Get that mic
up
close.
Absolutely.
We drove and we drove and we drove and we didn't see anything, and suddenly, boom, there's people.
Well, like I say, you know, you go to the where you drop off the end of the earth, turn left, and go 3 miles. You know, and then you're here. So.
Okay. Who are you? Where are we and what are we doing?
Okay. I'm Danny Osborne, W4DLO. I'm president of the Foothills Amateur Radio Club.
North Carolina.
Here in North Wilkesboro, North Carolina, in beautiful Wilkes County. And
we are on the top of the world, apparently. How high up are we?
Yes, we are. We're on the Brushy Mountains, a spot that's called Buck's Knob. And one of our club members owns the whole top of this mountain. It's where his home is. And he's invited us up to do our field day exercises this year. And this is also our club picnic. We have a yearly picnic for the club, so we just have a ball.
How high up are we?
2,350 feet. This is a beautiful spot. It's well taken care of, and so we're just proud to be here.
Yeah, this is great. So tell me about your field day. How many? What class category do you end up in?
Well, we're going to be operating 2A. And
with all these people, you can only put together 2A.
Well, we could put together more, but, you know, most of us are here for the camaraderie. And
it's a social
club,
event.
The club, actually, we don't do it for the points, so to speak. We'll be here till dark. You know, we don't operate the full field day event.
What are you putting up for antennas?
We've got ND4MR Dave. He's running a long wire. For 20 meters, 40 meters, I'm sorry, 40 meters.
Yep.
And you got we're putting up a cage dipole.
Which I wanted to tell you, it's not going to work.
Well,
where it
we
is
ain't
now.
Through yet.
Oh, okay. Well, you got a little time left.
Yeah, but
this
is a 20-meter cage dipole.
All right.
So we put it up in one tree here, and we're going to shoot another line over here, put it in a tree.
And stand by. He doesn't know the meaning of the word stand by, does he?
He was standing. I would like to mention, too, that we are, for those that might see this, it's local, ND4MR. He's a professor over at Wilkes Community College. Starting July the 24th, he's having a technician's licensing class. Anybody that... would like to, you know.
How many folks do you typically get for your classes? Is there a typical?
The last class he taught, we had 21 in it. Had 21 in the class.
That's pretty, because it's pretty rural out here.
It is, and, you know, the...
Although probably the area is less rural than I'm thinking because we drove up this windy mountain road forever.
We've got a lot of hams in Wilkes County.
And we are right next to your repeaters here, right?
Can
I see the tower?
DMR, yeah. The DMR, you see, just see the top of our DMR repeater tower. We're getting ready to add two more sections to it. So we'll be about another 20 feet higher than what we are right now. Good DMR coverage, good 2-meter coverage, so... you know, we're looking forward to it.
All right. Well, thank you very much. You guys have fun.
Thank you very much, Gary. Appreciate y'all coming.
Say Foothills. Foothills. It's a great photo, everybody.
We are on a road called the Blue Ridge Parkway. It's actually pretty amazing. It's a very bucolic road. It goes hundreds of miles with literally no stop signs, no stoplights, no cross traffic. I don't know how they did it. 45 mile an hour speed limit. It's not a super highway. It's a 2-lane road. So you can see the oncoming traffic. And initially you might think, well, it's wonderful, but for the most part, you are in a green canyon and all you see are trees. And after a while, you kind of get bored with just seeing trees. But once in a while, you break out of the trees and it's really pretty.
You're just outside of Blowing Rock in Watauga County, and this is the Watauga Amateur Radio Club's 2017 Field Day operation.
And we're still in North Carolina. We're not going to leave North Carolina, y'all.
No, you're definitely in North Carolina.
Because this is where the barbecue is.
Beyond those trees there, about 4 miles, is Grandfather Mountain. The south side, or actually the southeast side of Grandfather Mountain.
Okay, who am I talking to?
Marv Hoffman, WA4NC.
And?
Danny Horney, KE4AAP.
And what are you guys to this organization?
Past president.
President.
Okay, so you escaped.
Yes.
Yeah.
It took a long time,
and
though.
Stuck him with it.
That's exactly right.
Yes.
So what kind of field day operation you guys got going here?
Well, we've got a little bit of everything. We've got people doing CW on HF. We've got some DMR. We've got analog, 2 meters, 440. We've got a little bit of everything.
Yep.
All right. Things haven't started yet. It's not
That's
quite
correct. Field day. It is exactly 1:40 p.m.
So, 20 minutes to go.
Yes.
You're tense, nervous?
Oh, yes.
Are you ready?
Grinding my teeth.
This is the first time I've seen radios on and heard some noise from the from the two places we stopped before. Okay. So.
Well, you went to Wilkes, and so so we would expect that.
Go ahead. Get yourself and me in trouble.
No, they're good fellows down in Wilkes. We're very close to them. Foothills Amateur Radio Club, and your next stop, I understand, is going to be at Malin in Spruce Pine, and they're a good bunch, too.
So would you call, at Wilkes they were casual. It was social. It was not blood and guts field day. How is it here?
That's the exact same way we are. We're here for the camaraderie and the practice and just to have some fun with our radios.
But I think we're a little tougher than some because we're going to go 24/7.
Yeah, because okay, yeah,
whereas Wilkes is going to shut down when it gets dark.
They're going to get to their picnic and then go home.
Yep.
All right. So you have two stations. You're a 2A?
Oh, no, we're a 3A.
3A.
Oh, excuse me. 3D. We're running on commercial power.
Okay, and you're in an emergency center.
Yeah, but we ain't got formal permission from the ARRL, so we're running three Delta this year.
Okay, so you can't talk to any of the other Deltas, the stations at home.
No,
and I guess Foxtrot is the EOC type.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Right, exactly.
But you got to get the league has to tell us.
Well, for this to be a Foxtrot, we thought about that, but I'm pretty sure the ARRL has to approve this as a EC.
Okay.
So we're running 3 Delta because we're running commercial power instead of a backup.
The Lenore Club is working at their Caldwell County EOC.
Mm-hmm. Okay, hold that mic close because we're getting noisy around here.
Okay.
All right. Anything special or unique you guys do? Or just a routine field day?
Well, no.
Just a routine field day. Hope we sent a lot of letters out. I hope we'll get some invites after a while.
Yes. We've got literature in the room next door about, encouraging people to get into ham radio. We've got a class scheduled for the 15th, 16th, 22nd, and 23rd of July. So we're going to be running weekend classes, and we're going to have a test session on the 24th. So our club has grown quite a bit over the last 5 years, so we're very, very proud of that.
Do you expect to get very many visitors?
Well, we don't know. In one sense, this is a little bit off the beaten path. You know, if this was downtown in the park and Blowing Rock.
Is there a beaten path out here somewhere? I haven't found one. Yeah.
Closer to Boone and closer in town, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, there's a beaten path.
Yeah. Well, we came off the Blue Ridge Parkway. I feel like I've been in Never Never Land. Yeah.
Ain't quite as hot, and it's a fun thing to do. So.
All right.
Yeah.
What kind of antennas you guys put up?
Well, we've got some dipoles, and we got some verticals.
Yep.
We've
got an off-center back there, a 20-meter sloper. David's is a multi-band set up out here, your vertical. Mm-hmm. And I think there's a... two verticals that Doug has set up for the 220 and the 70 centimeter stuff.
No towers, no beams?
Mm-hmm. No.
And you were telling me that you used to run from the top of a mountain?
From up on Howard's Knob, overlooking Boone, at 4,060 feet. It was a great location, but tremendous weather.
Mm-hmm. Tremendously bad weather.
Exactly.
Tremendously variable weather.
Yeah. So you got either smarter or older or both?
We certainly got older, and what remains to be tested is whether or not we've gotten smarter.
But this is a whole lot more comfortable.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You needed to work out the emergency.
This is the first time we've been at this location.
Yeah.
I guess you need to work out the emergency power just to get into the total spirit of things.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Your blood and guts enough to stay all night.
We'll stay 24 hours all night.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Yep. Right. And then we don't have to listen to the acorns beating the car windows out.
Yes.
Trust me.
The what?
Acorns fell. Come a windstorm up on Harrod's Knob, and the acorns was actually, you could hear them boom, beating boom, the
bang,
car.
Bang.
Out, and it blowed her tents away. Yeah. And
the lightning, huddling in your car while lightning is striking around the all around you.
Yeah, I think you're in a better spot here.
Yep.
Yeah. All right, you guys will
probably
have fun.
Probably safer.
Yeah, have a great time.
Okay.
Thanks for coming and covering us, too.
Come back again.
Okay, well, you'd be one Delta. You're one Delta from home. So good luck, and it's working good. 73, QRZ, Whiskey 3, Yankee Alpha.
Whiskey 4, Lima.
Okay, station Alpha Kilowatt. Alpha Kilowatt, you're 3 Alpha WPA.
Whiskey 4, Charlie, Hotel X-ray.
Whiskey 4, Charlie, Hotel X-ray. Copy by 1 Echo, Tennessee.
QSL, 1 Charlie, North Carolina. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Copy by 1 Echo, Tennessee.
Roger, roger.
Okay, synchronizing 3, 2, 1, blip.
Blip.
I'm the guy that says blip. You don't get to say blip.
Okay.
Hold that microphone up close. Who are you and where am I?
I'm David Hauser, president of the Mayland Amateur Radio Club. We're in northern Mitchell County, North Carolina, on a field day setup, a place we haven't been before. Turns out it's been a very popular spot to be. We've been at more high traffic areas in the past, and we've had one or two visitors. We've had 6 or 7 people find us out here today, hidden where we are. So it's been a very interesting experience.
Karl and I got really lost trying to find us.
Oh, dear. Well, people overcame that and did find us.
But if we'd followed the written directions, we would have been fine.
Okay. Well, we did our part.
Yeah.
But so, people have found us. Non-hams have found us. They saw articles in the newspaper. Came out and wanted to find out what ham radio is about, spent time with us, had hamburgers and hot dogs. We've had a great day. Stayed under the tent during the rain.
It has rained?
It did.
Yeah, we haven't seen any yet. But, we, you know, driving around, we haven't encountered it. But you're supposed to, because field day is always on the fourth rainy weekend in June.
Right. No matter what happens, it's an emergency practice, and so we do.
Yep.
So we do.
So tell me about your setup here.
We have... 3, 4 different antennas. We got an 80-meter loop, horizontal loop.
What's your class?
3A, 3 alpha.
Okay.
We've got an 80-meter loop. We've got a VHF and UHF on a tower, and we've got a vertical, horizontal, quick deployment antenna that we're trying out. We had another fellow here earlier with a kind of a maypole 80-meter, 40-meter antenna.
Which antennas are working best?
The 80-meter loop's doing good. We're having good luck with that.
How are the bands today?
They're 20 meters is wide open. There's a lot going on. It's been very good.
And is that pretty much where you've been concentrating?
That's where we've spent most of our time, yes.
As long as it's open. Have you looked higher, 15, 10?
We haven't been up there, no.
Haven't even tried. All right. Who's your sidekick here?
I'm Bob Rogers, KC4 TVO. I'm the District Emergency Coordinator for Area 12 in North Carolina.
All right.
Seven northwest counties.
So that's a big, big territory, and all pretty rural.
All rural.
So how'd you get this collection of people for field day? It's a pretty good group of people.
Well, we just advertised more than anything else, and we've been very glad that we saw the amount of traffic that we've had this year, much more than previous years. And it's our first time at this particular site, and we're very pleased.
This is really beautiful.
It's working out very, very well.
Yeah. Are you guys going to do all night long, all day tomorrow?
No, we usually just hold it to one day. Everybody's burnt out by the end of the day.
Hold that mic close.
And full of hot dogs and hamburgers, so by then it's time to wrap it up.
So we had to catch you today or not at all?
Pretty much, yeah. Right.
And would you call this more of a social event?
For us, I think it probably is. Yeah. Yeah.
I mean, do people learn emergency procedures by doing this, if it's that social?
We spend time... training people. We've had several new technician license classes, so we've got 10 or 15 new hams, and this is an opportunity for them to come out, spend time with them, get them on the air, explain how repeaters work and digital DMR radios and so on, try to overcome that fear of mic fright and get started. We're able to sit down and spend considerable amount of time with each one as they want to learn how to get on the air, and then get exposed to HF and see the other bands working and why they might want to move on to general.
I hear the sounds of training going on behind me. What's going on?
A visitor is getting introduced to some digital modes, FL Digi and using sound card modes in the background there.
Okay, so you're not trying to make thousands of contacts. You're trying to teach people how to do something.
Yeah.
Awesome. All right. Anything special or unusual? Any strange antenna configurations you've never seen before?
Bob's got a new fast deployment emergency antenna.
Yeah, we're testing out a new antenna, alpha antenna, which supposedly is a combination of NVIS and a vertical. And we've played with it a little bit. There's more time needed on it to get it tweaked properly and so forth.
But, so no evaluation yet?
No pro or con yet. Just it sets up nice. And I have made some previous contacts with it before I got here, and it worked very well. So it's a very popular antenna, and it used a lot in deployment situations.
Do you guys do more phone or CW? I hear a lot of CW going on in the background there.
More phone and Winlink, digital. I'd say we do some CW, but not a great deal of it.
Because I'm hearing a lot of code going on back there. Is that just for show?
No, actually, they're running a digital program, and they're in the CW portion of the band, and they're reading CW with a program called FL Digi. So introducing this fella to the program and to digital in general.
All right. You guys having fun?
Oh, yes. Yeah. We do every year. Every year.
All right. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Field Day, November Radio 4, Mike.
Whiskey 4, Charlie, Hotel, X-Ray.
The W4 station again, go ahead.
Whiskey 4, Charlie, Hotel, X-Ray.
W4, Charlie, Hotel, X-Ray, correct?
QSL, 1, Charlie, North Carolina.
W4, Charlie, Hotel, X-Ray, this is NR4M, 5, Delta, Virginia, 5, Delta, Virginia.
QSL, 1 Charlie, North Carolina.
QSL, 1 Charlie, North Carolina. CQ Field Day, November Radio 4, Mike.
My name is Dudley Hale, and I'm the president of the Haywood County Amateur Radio Club, and we are in Clyde, North Carolina.
Okay, a bunch west of Asheville and way west in the state. There's only about 500 miles more west of North Carolina from here, right?
More west?
Yeah. You can keep going west.
Yes.
Still be in North Carolina.
Yes.
Until you get just about to Los Angeles.
That's correct. As long as you're in the mountains, you're still in North Carolina.
All right. So, Haywood County Amateur Radio Club. I can read that right on your sign.
Yes.
And who are you?
I'm David Bennett. I'm a member of the club.
Your call?
And we're pretty happy here.
Call sign?
KK4HGFR.
Okay, what do you got going here? It's field day, but tell me about your stations. What class are you?
We have five stations in the competition. We have some others operating. We have a couple of different modes operating. And we jump off, switch around, spell each other, and have a pretty good time and trying things out, too.
Okay, you got what? Sideband, CW?
PSK. And hopefully somebody will come later on for CW.
Okay, somebody who knows CW.
Yes, somebody who knows, exactly.
All right, and it looks like you got some VHF stuff going.
Yes.
And you have a pretty impressive array of especially wire antennas,
yes,
including a very unusual one that I saw back there that has 3 feed lines dropping off of it, but 2 of them have been cut in half.
Yes, that's the Franklin array, and it's about 280 feet long. It's about 70 feet in the air, and it's 40 meters only. And it's working, it's got about 7 dB gain. So it's working very well. And then down here, we have 160 meters, 80 meters, and 40 meter dipoles, 6 meter vertical, and a 10 meter vertical. We got 20 meters on a dipole and 15 meters.
I think one of the cool things about the antennas, we have no towers this year. And this is the first time on this site, and everything is in the trees. We've it's always been standing towers up all over the place to get stuff stretched. And so this is a first for us, and I think it's pretty cool.
But that means no beams.
Nothing. For the safety officer, it was a piece of cake because we didn't have to worry about putting towers up and falling over and things like that. Just shooting a wire up in a tree and pulling the wire up and a real safe operation.
So, and you're very spread out. Your stations are, you get some exercise.
Yes, this is a very large field. It's about 500 feet from this side to the other and 700 feet from here to the road. So we're
not
spread.
Not more than 1,000 feet to anywhere.
No, not more than 1,000 feet to anywhere. We're within a radius of 1,000 feet. We measure that off, believe it or not.
So is that what, to prevent interstation interference, or you just don't like each other that much? Or?
No, we tried it to get away from the interference, even though we have equipment to keep down the interference. We thought we'd get further apart and make sure it works better. So far, we're doing that.
Okay, so we're well into Saturday, 7:30, so 5.5 hours. How are things going?
They're going pretty good. I think we got about 250 contacts total from the five stations operating, and the second crew is due back at about 9 o'clock, and they'll be here all night.
And would you call this a social operation or a blood and guts contesters or a mix or somewhere in between?
It's more social, and we're not blood and guts, that's for sure.
But yeah, we're pretty much team building at the same time. We're having some fun.
All right, but you go all night?
Yes.
Somebody will be here all night?
Yes. 2 o'clock tomorrow, we'll be dragging to get everything tore down and out of here.
You're on a pretty busy highway, and you got some big signs. Anybody just drive in and say, what are you doing?
We've had a couple do that, and one of them was a ham from Silva.
Yeah,
he's a part-time resident, but other than that, most of them have been friends. We've had a couple people who we don't know show up.
You get the hams who say, "Yeah, I used to be active. I haven't had a ham station on in years and years."
Yeah, I haven't been to a field day in years, and I'm up here for 6 months. What are you guys doing? And
do you do a go-to station? Yes. And you get some newcomers that are learning the ropes?
We haven't.
Very rare.
We haven't been able to get any newcomers in. It's
You can sit them down or invite them to sit down at the station. It's all set up there under the canopy. They've got the permanent canopy even. You can get them to talk, and they're interested and question, but you invite them to sit down and
try to put them on the air.
You say, "Hey, but you can't mess it up. Just relax." But they don't seem to want to participate too much.
Mike Freight is universal.
Yes, it is.
All right, thank you guys. Have fun.
Our pleasure.
Yeah.
Kilo Whiskey 4 Papa.
4 Alpha in Ohio.
Okay, Kappa 2 Alpha Mississippi, please copy my 5 Alpha North Carolina, 5 Alpha November Charlie, over.
5 Alpha North Carolina, thanks for the contact. Good luck, 73.
Thank you, sir. Appreciate the contact.
Okay. Get that one put in.
You are in Hendersonville, North Carolina at the Blue Ridge Radio Club Field Day. I'm Danny Rector. I'm a field day coordinator for this group. We're a 3 Alpha station. We have a phone station behind me. We have a CW station, which right now we converted to phone because CW guys are not here. And we have a digital station set up. We also have a VHF station during the daylight hours.
That would be where this empty person is here.
That is it.
Yeah. No. So how's it been going?
It's been a good day, actually. Yeah, we've been doing pretty good on contacts. Had one storm earlier. We had to pull the plug for a little while and go inside. But other than that, we've been doing pretty steady on contacts. I think it's a little bit better this year than last year. We've been working 15, 20 meters.
15's opened up?
It was earlier. It's more, and actually, digital just opened up just a little while ago, 15.
Okay.
And then we worked 20 meters a lot, and been working 40 meters for the last little bit.
All right. What kind of antennas you got up here?
We have a spider beam.
You have a homemade, big spider beam.
Homemade spider beam.
Very large, extra ginormous economy size.
Yeah. And then we got a G5 RV that we'll be using more in the evening on 40 and 80. And then we have a Delta Loop hanging in the woods back here that we're doing our digital on. It's tuned for 20 and 40.
You're in a pretty public place.
Yes, we're in a park. The park is great. They sponsor us here and give us a place to stay and all. So it's called Jackson Park.
The park attracts people, and then they see something weird.
Yeah.
And they those that aren't afraid come check it out.
That's it. That is. We're right in the middle of a Frisbee course, so they're coming on both sides of us all the time.
Have you managed to put any of those people on the air?
Most of the time we'll get them logging or something like that, helping too. So, and they get to listening, and we'll get them to try it.
Okay, you guys going all night?
Yes.
All day tomorrow?
We'll be here all night. All the way to 2 o'clock tomorrow, though, till it lightens, and then we're going to stop for a little bit.
So,
I hear the phone guy. I'm going to go see if I can hear something from his headphones.
Go ahead. Go ahead.
All right, thank you.
All right, thank you for coming.
Whiskey 4, Yankee Kilo.
For 5, Mike Lima, please copy 2 Alpha, Mike India.
QSL, copy 1 Delta, Mike Sierra, Mississippi.
Thank you for Mississippi, 7-3. CQ Fielder, Whiskey 8, Mango November, Oscar.
Whiskey 4, Yankee Kilo.
Whiskey 4, Yankee Kilo, please copy 2 Alpha, Mike India.
Thank you, sir. This is Whiskey 4, Yankee Kilo. Please copy 3 Alpha, November Charlie.
Thank you for North Carolina, 73.
Okay,
what are you fixing?
Fixing as such isn't necessarily the best way to put it. It's an antenna I built before I came out here, and I just hadn't gotten a chance to hook it up to anything yet. I don't have any transceivers of my own right now.
Okay, who are you?
I'm Seth Lawson, W0ONAXKK4YXV. I got licensed a few years ago, back when I lived here with the Blue Ridge guys, and I moved down to Florida a few years ago, kind of got out of practice with the hobby, and came up here for a vacation this year and decided I'd drop in.
Show me the antenna.
Sure, follow me. All right, so here we are. It's this is a little 4-to-1 Balun I built. It's based on the same sort of circuit as the Elcraft BL1, just a little binocular toroid. It's 4-to-1 UN-UN, low impedance side here, high impedance here. It's a 3.6-meter wire here with a 10.4-meter wire going out there with a 6.4-meter wire hooked to the end of that. So it's a total of a half wave, more or less, on 40 meters. So it's resonant on 40, 20, 15, and 10. I haven't transmitted through it yet, but I took it out on the AT with me a couple weeks ago for a 20-mile hike.
The Appalachian Trail.
Yeah.
You carried it, but you didn't put any RF into it.
I didn't put any into it. I took some out of it. I brought my little shortwave receiver.
Okay.
And it's light, so I didn't really feel it, but
Did it work for a receive?
It overloaded my receiver. It was so good.
All right.
Yeah.
All right, so you can hook it up and see if it'll play.
I'm considering it, yeah. Mostly I just brought it to test it because I wanted to see if my models, all my fancy-dancy 4-neck 2 models, I wanted to see if they agree with real life. And they kind of do, almost, sort of, kind of, not really.
This is perhaps the most interesting field day site that we've been to, at least today, if not ever. Who was the genius who thought of doing field day here?
Well, one of our club members, Stan, recommended it, and he thought this would be a great place. So we asked AB Tech, they gave us permission, and this is our first time here, and we are on the 6th level of a new parking deck, with our antennas on the top 7th level, which is open. And some of the club members had a little reservations about this, but now that we're here and setting up, everybody loves being up here.
Okay, who are you and what is the group?
Okay, the group is West Cars, and my name is Randy, and my call is KI4VLW.
And by now you guys know we're in North Carolina.
Oh, we're in North Carolina for sure. In Asheville, North Carolina.
We could tell just by the way you talk, y'all. Eastern or Western North Carolina barbecue?
Western.
What a surprise from Western North Carolina.
Well, I'm a homeboy.
Okay, so what do you got set up? What's your class?
Okay, we are 6 Alpha. We have 6 stations.
You're big.
Yes.
And it's quieter here tonight right now.
Yeah, we're running off emergency generator power, and we had a bigger group here earlier, but everybody's gone to get a little shut-eye and be back in the morning.
So you can do this the whole all the way to the end?
Yes.
Anybody can stay all night?
Yes, I am going to stay all night, maybe a couple of more. So,
an operator sleep?
A little of both. A little of both.
So I guess the thing I would worry about in a somewhat urban environment like this at a college is noise. How are the how the noise levels?
Very little noise. Actually, this level down here has stainless steel sheeting around it, and it's like being in a big Faraday cage.
And but your antennas are up.
The antennas are up.
In an urban zone.
But it's very, very little noise. We are experiencing a little interference from time to time, probably from air conditioners, but it's not enough to interfere with us transmitting or hearing and getting in touch with other clubs and other field day sites.
All right. This time of night, this place is empty. Has it been busy during the day?
It's been very busy. We have probably had a total of roughly coming and going around 60, 65 people.
As visitors.
Visitors and operators. Some club members come and operated for a little while and went home.
All right. But the general public uses the parking lot.
Well, this is during the summer. The school is closed, plus it's being on the weekend.
Not so much.
Yeah, and we're here by ourselves. And actually, the security guard comes up and checks on us from time to time. So we feel great.
So it's general public-wise, not a lot of folks are just going to wander
by. But we probably had about 20, 25 visitors.
Well, that's still more than most people.
Yeah, and we posted it on Facebook and made checking into the nets, different nets in the area, and invited them to come out. And several has come. We had one to come as far as away from Winston-Salem, stopped by for a few minutes.
That's a pretty good trip.
Yep, he was traveling through the area, heard about us, and stopped by.
Good deal. So you'll do this again next year?
Well, the consensus says everybody wants to come back next year if the college will allow.
What kind of places were you before?
Fields. We actually, a few years, we was at the parking lot at the VA hospital here in town and out in the fields. But one reason why everybody likes this place up here, we got a breeze through, we're out of the weather, the sun, the rain, and it seems like it's about 10 degrees cooler under here than out in the sun.
So find a parking lot, a parking deck.
Yes, find a parking deck.
Preferably 70, 80 feet tall like this one.
And have fun with field day.
Yeah, actually probably more like 100 feet tall.
Oh, yeah, this was a big place.
It's night, so I can't see what's around us. Are we in a valley? Are we on a mountain?
We're actually on a plateau. And the line of sight on the top up there is very remarkable, very remarkable. And, of course, now we are in a valley here in Asheville.
So eventually we run into a mountain out there somewhere.
We're surrounded by mountains, but still we're getting good results and making a lot of good contacts.
Are you doing any VHF, UHF stuff?
No, we're not doing any of that. Mostly we've got one digital station, 15-meter station, 40-meter station, 20-meter station, and probably we'll have an 80-meter station here in a little while.
All right, so my antenna theory is remarkably weak for as long as I've been a ham. You don't have much earth beneath you. You have concrete. That doesn't seem to be a problem. The elevation
I tried one antenna, my G5RV, but unfortunately the ladder line and the steel in this building did not mesh, you might say, and I had a hard time tuning it up.
So you got to run coax to everything from under here.
So I switched to a regular dipole antenna with no ladder line, and the band, 20-meter band, is doing good.
Okay, so get yourself a parking deck, but run coax.
Oh, yeah, definitely. Long coax and a good generator.
Yeah. All right, thank you very much.
Thank you, and appreciate you having us.
Stay West Coast. Let's go.
Whiskey 4, Charlie, Hotel, X-Ray.
Kansas Charlie, Hotel.
Whiskey 4, Charlie, Hotel, X-Ray.
Whiskey 4, Charlie, Hotel, X-Ray. We are 2 Alpha, Michigan.
Roger, 1 Charlie, North Carolina.
Charlie, North Carolina, got it.
You are at the Caldwell County Emergency Operations Center. I'm Tom Land, KA4HKK. I'm the Caldwell County EC.
And who's your buddy?
I am John Crow, AG4ZL. I'm the president of the Lenore Amateur Radio Club.
And apparently this is field day.
Yes,
it is.
How many of you stayed up all night?
Two of us, and the other one is gone right now. I don't know what happened to him.
Okay, so you stayed up all night.
I stayed up all night.
So I've got you at a severe disadvantage because I've had like 4 hours of sleep.
Yeah.
How are you doing?
I'm a little groggy.
What band did you operate?
I've been on the 80, 40, 20. Pretty much 80, 40, 20, doing some CW and some sideband.
Okay, so probably 20 closed up overnight?
Yes.
So 80 and 40, which
means? 80 and 40 were pretty good.
You've had static in your ears all night long.
Well, I actually learned how to do the RF gain and turn it down a little bit to cut out a lot of that static.
How do you know the secret?
That's right.
Yeah, although you got to keep working it,
right?
Because your AGC goes away.
Mm-hmm.
It's a little technical detail for you guys at Ham Radio now. What's your station class here this year?
We are 2 Alpha, North Carolina.
And before we started rolling, I think you said this is smaller than usual.
It is. Last year we had 3, and we've had as many as 5 years ago. It's been between 3 and 4, and like I say, 2 this year.
So just too hard to gin up the interest to find the spark plugs to run the station?
The people that usually help had other things to do, so they couldn't help out.
Don't
this
tell
year.
Me there was a wedding, because I keep hearing about people having weddings on field day.
No, actually, one was because of a thunderstorm, some storm damage a fella had to take care of.
Yep.
And another was on vacation with his wife, so there was a wedding at some time.
Field day is on the calendar, people.
That's right.
Yeah.
We always know when it's going to be. The 4th rainy weekend in June.
We didn't get any rain this year.
Oh, you're one of the few.
I know, I heard.
It hit just about everybody. So what bands have you been operating?
I've been operating on 20 meters 90% of the time.
Phone, CW?
A lot of phone. Okay. We've worked a lot, believe it or not, with our new beam up there. We've worked a lot of the West Coast and the East Coast. We missed a lot of that last year, so we kind of had an advantage to getting all the states. The bands, believe it or not, 20 meters has been really good. A lot of short skip coming into 20 meters. We were working a lot of local Tennessee, Virginia, and Georgia. But for some reason, South Carolina didn't want to come to the show until about 12 hours ago. So
no multipliers in field day, so you know it's just an interesting thing.
Yeah. So.
What is your antenna setup?
My antenna setup is the Mosley TA33 Junior.
And a nice little mobile tower.
Yeah, it's got a little... telescope 40-foot telescoping mast. We also got a 2G5 RVs that are hanging off the one off the trailer and one directly behind us here. So like you said a minute ago, we are a lot smaller than what we usually are, but it's been really productive, so we're quite impressed with the outcome so far.
Okay, you are just down from the detention center. It's right down there. Any jailbreaks overnight?
No, we had a trustee come over and sign in.
Did anybody get locked up?
A lot of people in and out.
I mean, from the hams.
Oh, no, not yet. I kind of figured in the first couple of hours, if we were going to come over their communication systems, we would know because we'd probably be on our way over there.
Okay, but they did come by. Does that count as an official visit?
I don't know. It'd be nice to know that, though.
We didn't invite them. Not the trustee.
They didn't show up. But, you know,
he just showed up.
Yeah, he just showed up.
A representative of an agency.
Yeah, state.
I don't know. That might qualify.
Hey, he's in a county facility, so we needed a county executive to get some bonus points. So
anything special or unusual about your operation that you want to brag to the world about?
Well,
you got the solar.
Yeah, we got some solar set up over here, and he's been running CW on solar 90%. It's been very effective. We're quite impressed with the setup and that. And
now, do you run a full power station doing that, or a 5-watt station?
100 watts.
Okay, so it sucks that solar panel dry real fast.
It held its own. We made, I guess, 30 contacts, maybe 40, and we didn't use it after that because we were afraid whenever the thing was turned off, the equipment that charges the battery would come on, and it caused a lot of interference. So,
so there's a learning point,
right,
for figuring out how to mitigate that.
Mm-hmm.
So, would you guys call your operation casual social or contest or blood and guts?
Oh. A little bit of both.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Which one of you guys is the blood and guts?
I have to nominate Tom. He's the one that sits behind CW all the time. I come in and pick up the slack, though.
John does a lot of good voice operation. He sits on a frequency and keeps the frequency occupied, and a lot of people jump on him instead of, like I do in the CW, I usually hunt and pounce.
Right. Yeah. So let me ask a question, because Carl and I have been operating mobile a lot as we've gone from station to station. There's more time spent driving in the car than being here at the stations. How often do you guys run into a Charlie class station? Usually a one Charlie.
We've worked so many. I don't really think I've worked any mobiles. I don't remember.
So we're kind of unusual.
Unusual class.
And it's fun to do. It's you know, also search and pounce, and it's slow, but I mean, we're up to 52 contacts.
Yay.
But that's just driving between sites, so
yeah,
it's kind of cool. All right, well, thank you, guys. I'll get some shots from around the facility you got here.
Yeah, thank you for coming.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
QSL 59 North Carolina, you're 59 Tennessee. 59 Tennessee, and I'm 1 Delta. 1 Delta. W3GOE.
Okay, and my section is 5 Alpha. 5 Alpha. Over.
QSL the 5 Alpha.
All right, thanks for the call. Great signal, by the way. 73. Good luck. QRZ Field Day, Kilo Whiskey 4, Papa.
November 4, Lima, November, Romeo.
November 4, Lima, November, Romeo. Please copy 5 Alpha, North Carolina. Over.
Roger, this is 2 Alpha, November, Charlie.
QSL, got it. Thanks for the call. QRZ, Kilo Whiskey 4, Papa. CQ Field Day,
November 4, Kilo.
November 4, Kilo, this is November 4, Lima, November, Romeo. November 4, Kilo, this is November 4, Lima, November, Romeo.
Okay, I have November 4, I'm sorry, sir. It's my first year. Say again.
That's okay. This is November 4, Lima, November, Romeo. We are 2 Alpha, 2 Alpha, November, Charlie. 2 Alpha, November, Charlie.
Okay, please copy. 2 Alpha, Virginia. Over.
Roger, roger. You are 2 Alpha, Virginia. 2 Alpha, Virginia.
Have a good day.
Thank you, 73.
I need to interrupt before we go to the next station. From a video standpoint, this trip was going pretty well, considering how many times I had to set up the mics and the cameras and then take them all apart and chuck them in the back of the car. But at this next site, I had a problem. Now, my wireless mics are part of what sets Ham Radio Now apart from other shows. I've always got great audio. Here are some of the mics, and this is the wireless part, the wireless transmitter. And this is the camera that I use in the field. The camera part down here and all this stuff up here is audio, including these two wireless mic receivers. So that's a little bit of the system. Here's some technical details about them. They operate in the television band. There's not really a wireless mic band. There's a couple of frequencies available in the VHF high band for like toy wireless mics. But the professional stuff are Part 15 devices, and they're authorized to operate on an unused television channel in any given location. And now I can set the frequencies on these for anything from TV channel 40 through channel 45. That's 626 through 662 megahertz. And they'll operate anywhere in there in 25 kilohertz steps. So when I'm planning on using them in some city, I'll check a chart to see what channel is empty in that city. And then I'll set the mics on a couple of frequencies in that channel. Now, TV channels are 6 megahertz wide, so there's plenty of room for two mics to stay more than a megahertz apart, which is, well, more than I need to prevent interference between the two. But on this trip, we were covering a lot of territory, and there was no one vacant TV channel in all of that territory. TV stations, Asheville area, down in Charlotte area, in the Winston-Salem area on different channels, and there was no one empty channel for
the entire territory. So I had to move the mics from one channel to another, just between two channels, depending on where we were. And at this next stop, at Granite Falls, I screwed up. At the previous stop in Lenore, the one you just saw, I've been using one hand mic, okay, the hand mic, and one lavalier. And let's see, this is the wrong camera. Here's the lavalier. And this is the kind of mic that you'll see a news anchor wear, you know, stuck on their lapel. I could see it good there. Or a late show TV host. That's the kind of mic that they use. Now, here's the trick that I learned. Most field day operators are wearing headphones. And if you want to record what they're hearing, the stuff off the air from their receivers, you need to tap into that receiver. Now, I could put a splitter in their headphone line, but that's disruptive. It's going to take them off the air for a moment. That could be a problem. So I don't want to do that. So what I figured out was I could just slip one of these little lavalier mics into the cup of their headphone, and it wouldn't take them off the air, wouldn't really stop them from doing anything. It's tiny enough that they don't feel it, but it picks up the sound from inside their earphones just fine. And that's what I was doing in Lenore. Are you with me so far? Is this making sense? Well, I've only got two wireless receivers, so there we go, the two receivers up on top of the camera. So if I want to switch between using a lavalier and a hand mic, I've got to turn off one, turn off the lavalier, and turn on the other one, turn on the hand mic. And so in Lenore, I had set up one hand mic and one lavalier on the channels available in that area. And that was a new day in a new location, so I had to move things around a little bit. At the next stop, just down the road from the at the Foothills Community Workshop in Granite Falls, I wanted to use two hand mics. So I turned the lavalier off, and I turned on the second hand mic. But apparently, I forgot to set the second hand mic to the new channel for that area. Normally, I check the mics before I start shooting. I put on the headphones, I look at the meters on the camera, I make sure everything sounds good. And I could swear that I did that this time. But when I got to the next stop, after I shot everything in Granite Falls, I got to the next stop and I did check, I found that one mic wasn't working. One of the two hand mics, because it was on the wrong frequency. It was on the frequency from the previous day. And I thought, oh, shoot. Did I lose that last interview? Well, when I checked playback after I got home, I discovered that, yes, I did lose one of the mics in that interview. And, of course, it was the mic that I handed to my guests. So, poop. My mic did pick up their voices. But when I turn the volume up high enough for you to hear them, there's a lot of background noise, and you can hear me breathing and stuff. So I'm not going to air their entire interview with that bad audio. What I'm going to do, I'll play a little bit of that in just a minute so you can hear what it would sound like and you can hear the guys. But then I'm going to come back on and I'm going to describe in my nice, clean, clear audio what it was that they were telling me. All right. Sorry. We're at the Foothills Community Workshop. It's in the small town of Granite Falls. This is a makerspace kind of thing. It's created in an old cotton mill. And I noticed the vertical antenna on the side of the building. And also notice that blue door. More on that in a minute. So let's go inside. And now, here's me. So what we have here is a rare sit-down interview opportunity indoors. We've been at some unusual places this field day. And this may not be the most unusual place we've been. I think maybe the parking garage is one of the more unusual places. But this is a little bit special, it would appear. Let's find out about it. Who are you guys? Hold that microphone up close.
Okay. Well, I'm Michelle Sudruth. I'm a geek from day one. And
what's your call sign?
KD4YTU. I'm one of the founders.
Okay, you're one of the founders. All right. And who are you?
And this is Mitchell Mast, KN4AYD. Mitchell is a brand new ham. He's one of several that Michelle has recruited from the people who came to the workshop to make things or to learn how to make things. Mitchell's background is from the military. He did communications and electronics in the Army. And we all talked about the natural connection between hams and makers. Michelle said that she was recruited to the workshop by the other founders because of her involvement in the local radio club. Now, the workshop itself isn't a radio club, but they do maintain the station there for any licensed ham in the area to come in and use. And of course, all the folks who come to use the workshop see the station, so they get an introduction to ham radio. They teach a lot of classes and everything you can do in the workshop. They've got this nice classroom. And of course, that includes amateur radio. And that's how Mitchell got his license. They've just received permission to install a tower, and that's going to really improve their antenna setup. Michelle and Mitchell were operating field day as 2D. It's one of those casual operations that's designed more for introducing visitors to ham radio than being a blood and guts contest. And they did have several visitors stop by. The workshop space is huge. It's got a ton of equipment from electronics to woodworking and metalworking and this big train set. And the guy who built the train set has got a sense of humor. The workshop's even got an electron microscope and a laser cutter that they can make all kinds of interesting things with. And finally, I think I mentioned the front door.
So I missed this coming in, but if you're a Doctor Who fan, you'll recognize what this is. And if you're not, it won't matter.
Well, maybe just this once.
It's called the TARDIS. Time and relative dimension in space.
Your spaceship's made of wood. There's not much room, we'd be a bit intimate.
Take a look.
It's bigger on the inside.
Is it?
I noticed.
When we first got this place, we stood at that door and shone a flashlight, could not see the other end.
It's bigger on the inside. All right, sorry guys for messing up your interview. You have got an awesome place. Maybe not as pretty as some of the commercial maker spaces, but it's a work in progress, and they've got literally a ton of equipment. Maybe 2 tons. So thanks for the tour. Now it's time for Karl and me to get back on the road and on the air. And this time it's a DMR contact with our Roanoke Division Vice Director, Bill Marine, N2COP. And he was down in South Carolina on his own field day tour and without a film crew.
Hey, stranger, good to hear you. N2COP here. Go ahead.
I need to figure out where I'm going in. Am I going in here?
Yeah.
Whiskey 4 Charlie Hotel X-Ray.
Whiskey 4 Charlie Hotel X-Ray, please copy 2 Alpha Eastern Mass.
Roger, roger. 1 Charlie, North Carolina, thank you.
1 Charlie NC, thank you. Have a good day, 73.
So we're winding down, got less than 1 hour left. And we have stopped at one more field day location. Which one have we stopped at?
You're at the Iredell County Amateur Radio Society's 2017 field day.
And you guys seem to have a pretty significantly going operation here. It looked pretty big as we were driving in. What's the class?
We're operating 5 Alpha.
Do you have 5 stations going pretty much all the time? Do you go all night?
We went all night long. Started 2 o'clock yesterday, and we still currently have 1, 2, 3, 4 on the air at the current time.
So would you call this a blood and guts or casual, just having a good time, or?
We pretty much have just a good time. We're not really serious contesters. We have tried to make our migration away from hardcore contesting and make it more of a family-oriented ordeal.
to get more people to come in and play?
Absolutely. And we sent out this year, for the first time, we sent out postcards to over 300 amateur radio operators in our county that we don't have a clue who they are, what they're doing. We only have about 40 members in our club. So, again, it's a way to reintroduce some of those folks to amateur radio.
Well, that's a great idea. How did it work?
So far, so good. We've had a lot of good response. Probably had about 20 extra hams that showed up to this weekend that we honestly did not know as a club.
So they said, I got that postcard, and I remember Field Day. It's been a long time.
Mm-hmm. That's exactly how it came about. And we got a few of them in here to come in and operate a little bit or discover new modes, things of that nature. Some of the old timers that kind of showed us the way in CW, they wanted to look at some of the digital modes and things of that nature.
Okay. You know, I think I forgot to ask who you are.
My name is Rick McClure. I'm the president of the club.
And your call sign?
Kilo Echo 4 Tango Echo Papa.
Okay, what's the call sign that you're operating with the club?
Whiskey 4 Sierra November Charlie is our club call.
So I ask everybody what unusual thing you've done, and you've already told me your unusual thing is you sent out postcards and invited people in, and it worked. Hams, how about the general public? You're in a public place.
Yeah, general public, we invited as many as we could through social media, through our newspaper, through our local radio stations, and we've had a few.
Did they do stories for you?
They did do stories. We had one in the paper, and we've had the other real media outlet we had was the radio station. They where we house our repeater. They've always been
so
good to
us. So they know about you.
They know who we are.
Yeah, you're up on their FM tower.
Yes, sir. It's actually right over your shoulder.
Oh, cool. So you got good coverage here at Field Day site.
Yes, we do. No problems with it.
Is anybody actually listening on the repeater right now?
They should be. Everybody. We have HTs at all of the stations, and
they're all turned off.
They may be turned off, but. We have a talk around frequency today, 147.510, so that we can, if we have a problem from one end of the field to the other, we can deal with it.
I've always thought that was a great idea. I've never been successful in implementing it at my local club. So, a few people would turn it on, but most people didn't, and as soon as it started making noise, they turned it off.
And we've been real lucky this year, and we also employed DMR radios on Simplex. So we could work either one, depending on if the person happened to have the DMR radio.
Okay, that's a good idea, too. And add D-Star and Fusion, and everyone can have their own mode, and no one can talk to each other.
That's true, too. That is true, too.
All right, what's your antenna configuration? You got some good stuff
here. We have a 20-meter beam that we're working right here with this group. We have 40-meter dipole for voice. We have 40-meter dipole for digital. And then we have two off-center fed dipoles for other bands.
Oh, you got a bucket truck there.
Got a bucket truck.
But there's
here.
Just like a UHF vertical on it.
That's exactly right.
It seems a little underutilized.
Well, actually, what's going on in that bucket truck, in that van right now, is our Field Day radiograms are being passed on Windlink through that antenna, and it is being transmitted to the south end of our county.
Okay, so the Windlink you're using is the VHF packet version as opposed
Correct.
To the HF PacTor version.
Correct.
And is that something you guys use a lot?
Yes, that is something our club has been very conscious of, trying to build a more robust packet network in our county.
Packet's an antique.
It is, but it still works.
Got one of our served agencies showing up to visit us today. The Monticello Volunteer Fire Department.
Field Day is over.
That it is.
Did you have a good time?
Yeah, we had a good time.
You look right in the doing the mobile operating while we are heading between the sites?
It was a lot of fun because obviously it's a nice car to drive, a lot of well equipped. Had you looking at the computer, operating radios. On occasion I could handle the mic and make the cues and work together like a typical Field Day pair.
So you think we hit, a dozen sites?
I think we hit 10,
okay.
You and I, between Saturday and Sunday.
Yeah. And a variety of places. The parking deck, I think, was particularly fun.
Yeah, I think, each, as I've said before, each of the clubs has an approach to Field Day that is unique for the club, important for that club, that works well for that club, And I always enjoy seeing their solutions because they're operating at varying sites. Some of the sites are obviously beautiful, well-equipped, and have great coordination between local jurisdictions that might control the sites. It's pretty cool.
Yeah, they've done a good job. I like seeing, because anybody who operates field day gets out there and hears the stations on the air. So you know that there's thousands and thousands of people that are operating. I like seeing the variety of ways people do it. A lot of similarities between stations, but some differences and some specialties.
No question.
So it's just, it's invigorating to see it all. It is disappointing to see that the population continues to age, along with you and me. You know, mm-hmm. we're representative of the wave of hams pushing into, right. you know, late baby boomerism.
Right.
And that is sad, so few kids to encounter. So obviously that's something that ham radio is still struggling with and having to work with. That's maybe my only downside.
Yeah, but, you know, at least we're enjoying it. Everybody's having a good time. And not much more to say. You know, looking forward to Field Day 2018.
Yeah, another one is in the books.
That's right.
That will be it for this episode of Ham Radio Now, another field produced, which means you're not going to see it the day after Field Day. It's taking me a while to edit.
Thank you very much, everyone.
Tell people who you are.
My name is Karl Bowman. I'm from Raleigh, North Carolina. Call sign W4CHX, and I'm the North Carolina section manager.
And I am Gary Pierce, KN4AQ. David is way over there in California someplace. Can't come on the field productions. He tried to Skype me, but we were out of cell phone coverage range most of the time. Right. Ham radio is it for our communications.
Right, right.
But he would remind you that Arvin is our chief financial officer, so if you enjoy the programs and get something out of them, hamradionow.tv, go see Arvin. He's sitting over there. I left him in the ham shack. His nose is out of joint. I didn't even bring the portable Arvin with me. I didn't think to bring him. He could have come along.
Would have been a full car.
So that's it. 73, everybody. Over. Over.
Okay. 73, everyone. Over.
No. You say and out. Okay, you can do the over part.
All right.
Go 73,
everyone. 73, everyone. Over.
And out.
Want me to go again?
No. We're good. I'm going to give my 5-9 rant. What good is a signal report if every signal report is 5-9?
Well, that's an interesting question. If you want to look at that from a contester standpoint, I've asked that question. And what experienced contesters have said to me is that when someone sends a 5-9, and it's always a 5-9, it's not the signal report that's the issue. What it is, it's a signal that what comes after the 5-9 or the 599 on CW is, in fact, the exchange. So, like, I know what I'm contesting.
So it's a preamble.
Exactly. And so when I say, you know, 5-9 on that, I may then send the exchange for that particular contest. So okay. I actually don't have a problem sending 5-9 only. However, in DX, I will say I tend to send a real signal report.
Okay. I've been a ham for 52 years now. It used to be real signal reports. The reason they just do 5-9, it's not a preamble. It's not setting somebody up. It's hams got lazy. Takes too much thinking to give a real signal report. So everybody's 5-9. You're 5-9, old man. Good luck in the contest.
Like I gave my reasons why I say 5-9 in contests. And from there, we'll just have to let each individual ham decide what's correct.